remotely, travels by phones educating the next generation of healthcare professionals, providing state-of-the-art and compassionate care to everyone, regardless of their ability to pay, and conducting innovative research to find cures and treatments to improve the quality of life for the future generation. We have started this series of living laser interventions of medicine, and today we have with us Professor Dr. N.K. Mehra, an Indian immunologist, and will listen to his lecture today. Now I'd like to request our principal controller of medical college, Dr. Meenaxi Saxena, to please welcome our guest panel. I request her now to please welcome our today's expert speaker, Dr. N.K. Mehra. A big round of applause. The professor, Dr. N.K. Mehra, sir. I request ma'am to please welcome our director, Dr. Pankaj Singh, sir.
Those kind of people will get here and they speak to you and and then there is a lot of, there can be a lot of discussion as well. And they basically, you know, are a role model to not only our students who come in close contact with them and try to start emulating them, but also to our faculty who get a chance to discuss with these, you know, really great experts in the, who are there in the field of medicine. So it benefits all of us, and it's a great opportunity. Now coming to Professor K Mehra, he is actually, if you know him, he was it's known as Dean of Research at R&D Institute of Medical Sciences. But more than that, he was known as the person who started a whole discipline of transplant immunology. Actually, he is an immunologist also. He is also into many fields actually. You might make some of the data. All his achievements, and he has been honored with some of the topmost awards in the field of medicine, in the field of teaching, which anybody can aspire. So he has received topmost awards from ICMR, CSIR, etc. But more than that, I think what he did for AIIMS was he started the HLA lab, which I think was the first in the country at that point of time. And also he started this whole discipline of transplant immunology. As you know, in transplant, it is, you can give an organ which could be from a cadaver or which could be even from, somebody who's living, for example, in kidney, or somebody who has recently died, for example, in organ transplantation. But the issues are that once you transplant this organ, whether the body will accept it or not, I think that is the biggest issue. And if for that, so that the body can accept that organ, I think there is a lot of pre-work done to see that the organ is given to the correct individual so that there is a least rejection. And immunological reactions are the topmost events that cause rejection of an organ. And therefore, this whole field of transplant immunology to make sure that the organ that is being received is well accepted by the host and well accepted by the recipient, and there are no reactions. But even once the organ is acutely accepted, there are situations where over a course of time there could be some rejections. I think therefore key for any good transplantation is not only the technique. For example, cardiac transplantation, the technique is also very important, and so many other things are important. But the key to long-term success of any transplant project is the immunology. And therefore, this whole field of transplant immunology is a very advanced field where we make sure that the organs that are received are not wasted and they are not rejected. So with this particular idea, we have requested Professor K Mehra, who is the pioneer of, we can say, pioneer of transplant immunology in the country, to deliver his lecture and basically educate us on all the aspects and basically motivate our students and faculty as well, so that they can also one day be pioneer of something in the field of medicine. So with this, I welcome you again to this very interesting session, which I hope will be a big learning for all of us. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. These sessions have been very, very interesting and informational, and I think the students sitting here are very lucky to hear to the legends of medicine. And we did a survey, in the sense we gave a feedback form to all the students last time for the benefit of the dignitaries. I'd like to tell you, 90% of the students, we got very good reviews. Very good reviews in the sense that they said that they benefited from this and they are looking forward to more such sessions. So big round of applause for all of us in the university. Now I'd like to call upon the director of NIMS University, Dr. Pankaj Singh, sir, for his address. A big round of applause for Dr. Pankaj Singh. He has started to give an excellent word to you. Thank you.
Thanks for the kind words. First of all, I'd like to take this opportunity to welcome Dr. K Mehra, who is a renowned transplantologist in India, and he's been European academics in all the sort of medical sciences, which has been very, you know, highly recommended boost for anyone for us as a doctor. And he's currently surveyed, I think, SRL, so, thank you very much for coming all the way, sir, and blessing with your kind words, which you are delivering soon. Also, take this pleasure to thank Dr. Sundeep Mishra, who has been pioneer and acting as a, you know, central axis and driving force for many of these diseases, which are enlightening our lives and not only giving us, you know, a plethora of valuable information, also motivating us to do something, you know, better in our lives. Dr. Chandrama, a lifelong inspiration for me, and he is also a very, you know, important member of our group, who is being, you know, working hard for to make these things possible. Also, Dr. Meenaxi Saxena, and goes without saying, very hardworking lady, and she's been, you know, delivering things on time, over time. And Ms. Jasleen Garcha from Archumbi Foundation, thank you very much for coming all the way. And I'm sure she will share insights with you. And Mrs. Simi Singh, she's also from the same foundation. And Dr. Alwalia, my consultant, one of the respected consultant ophthalmologists, thanks for coming and organizing all these things. And that's all for you. So, first of all, friends, I would like to start, you know, on a very simple note. We all know that lives will end. Aaj bhi to kaun sab ko ek jana hai. Lekin jaise ki Archumbi Foundation ka ek tagline which I like really, ki be someone else's hero. So, aaj agar hum log ye maan ke chalte hain ki we can donate or organ, you know, any tissue from our body, I think that is one way, only one way probably so far to make yourself immortal, or at least you increase your issues like expectancy, if you like. जब हम लोग रहते नहीं हैं, हमारी जो एक बॉडी है, that is, you know, immortal, ultimately क्या होता है कि that is being destroyed. So that is the main motivating factor which, you know, we should always consider. जब organ transplant की बात जहाँ तक आती है, तो ऐसा रहता है, remember one of the first successful organ transplant was performed in 1870. So people, they think that it was in mid-50s, 1950s, and what the transplantation. And kidney comes in the mind. Yeah, that was transplantation, so it's better of all. People, they think of kidney, because at least, you know, for, you know, half a century, the transplantation and kidney was synonymous. Kidney ke alawa dusri cheez log kam sochte the. Lekin jo first transplantation hua tha, so that was bone transplantation. So it was a very, you know, primitive effort. जहाँ पे लोगों ने एक डेडबॉडी से बोन निकाली, कैडेवरी बोन्स लेके एंड दे ट्रांसप्लांटेड इट अनदर ह्यूमन बीइंग. देन सेकंड ट्रांसप्लांटेशन जो हुआ था, व्हिच आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट, इट्स इसी ट्रांसप्लांट का हुआ, और इसी ट्रांसप्लांट वाज डन इन 1870 एंड दैट वाज अ सक्सेसफुल ट्रांसप्लांट वी आर कॉलिंग. सो इट वाज इजीर जॉब इन वन वे, बट द कांसेप्ट वाज वेरी डिफिकल्ट. जिस ने पहली बार कांसेप्ट ट्राई किया उसको it was, you know, that person's brain ki kya sochte the. Iskin was the first, you know, successful transplantation. Then there was a kind of, like, you know, silence for, I don't know, more than 150 years or 170 years. Uske baad jo hai, jo pehla kidney transplantation hua, so that was performed in Illinois, Chicago, way. And that was, you know, performed by a team of doctors, including Dr. Lawler was the one guy. And there was another Japanese called James West. So in Gorona, they basically came here, they took a cadaveric kidney, and there is a lady called, the patient's name is quite famous now, she was the first one, the first that she came. So Ruth was the name, the first name, I remember, I can't remember the second name. So she was basically, another guy's kidney was transplanted to her. उसमें जो है जो HLA typing और tissue जो imaging है competitively concept नहीं थी and basically it was just done, you know, as you know, kind of empirical way. Transplantation took only 45 minutes, so very fast. And that time, actually, the anesthesia was quite primitive and involved. The surgeons were supposed to do the fast job. So the quality of job was not that important. The time, it was a race against time, if like. So, faster the surgeon, the better they used to call them. So Mehra transplantation, 45 minutes they called here, and then basically the patient, the kidney was rejected in 10 months. So three coffee survived the main kidney. The main criteria they used at time was very, very kind of primitive criteria. Blood group matching HGC with the coffee survey, because ABA compatible, ABA blood group watch with it. Then second thing that they used is sex as a gender. And third thing was body weight and the body size. Very, very primitive thing which I don't think they're using nowadays as a criteria for any successful transplantation. So when Mehra transplantation happened, it was that kind of paved the path and it opened a new dimension for doctors and surgeons. And that's how the transplant surgery started. In India, mein, transplant surgery was about 11 years ago, which is again a commendable job in one way. So we usually India lags behind technology and different innovations by a gap of around 50 to 60 years. But that's not something that we have to do with any other thing. We don't have to do with any other thing. But still, I think there's a lot of sense in taking Edward Mowery, Memory Hospital in Mowery. We have to do it again, and I think that was a successful result. Slowly, the concept of HLA typing and matching these things, they started coming. And now the transplantation has taken a completely different sphere, a completely different horizon. As Dr. Sundeep Mishra just mentioned, a successful transplant not only depends on the technique, also it's very important how well matched the donor and recipients are. So that is very, very important. So now this is something which kind of gives us an idea of how important the role of transplant people are there. So there is always a need, and we know it's a need out there. Now, if we talk about, say, slightly taking a different from the topic of transplantation, coming to there is a big stigma there. Maybe transplant karna jo hai, doctors are always ready, and transplantologists are always ready. And we guys on retreat, we always know that more than 200,000 at this is a very valuable provision which can be saved by giving different tissue by donation. We basically more about stigma as a society. So that is number one thing which we need to kind of avoid that stigma and remove that stigma somehow. This is the mindset change and applying on it. And we are the people who are leaders from the society. Unko ye cheez hai, isi tarike se, we have to run in that message. Ye message deliver karna padega. Aur problems kya hai? Unko ko kaafi is haan mein surgeon. So brain dead, itne karna patient ko it's unfortunate part of my job. But we do it in every day. So jab patient brain dead ho jata hai, to now what happens? The first thing is, society and family customer to hai. But I think one important factor is here, the law is not on our side. Foreign countries, and especially UK and US, when we talk about that, family consent is important, family agreement is important, but also the law basically takes over the family consent. Especially, any unborn situation when comes to us, used to come to us in UK or US, in UK especially, doctors are main deciding factor to have the family patient is allowed. So, nobody can consent for the patient other than the patient themselves. Other patient unconscious says Jesus was such a 15 hai. So in that case, this consent or not consent won't be valid. So what do we do? We have to consent sign. So that was, maximum two doctors consent would be, and not more than that was required at any time. There were no litigations, there were brain pain, there were no outbreak. Because doctors were very ethical as well, which I have realized, and I think this is a gap which we need to bridge here. In India, we have unethical practices which I want to double clear. We are kind of like, when I say we, as a community I'm working about, we are the responsible for few of these things. So law is not protecting us in one way. And the second thing is coming to the first point, stigma is there. Stigma kya hota hai ki bhai, logon ko ye lagta hai ki jo body hai, agar usko usse koi organ nikal lete hain, to the drugs ko stories ki agle janam mein jo hai wo bina us particular organ ke paida hoga, ya ho sakta hai usse mukti na mil paaye, salvation na mil paaye usko, या और भी बहुत सारी चीजें हम डिफरेंट रिलीजन से इसमें प्रोवोक करते हैं. लेकिन हम सब सारे रिलीजन एक चीज मानते हैं, ठीक है, वी हिंदूज वी इस्लाम वी सिक्स या एनी अदर रिलीजन क्रिश्चियनिटी दैट फॉर दैट मैटर, कि मरने के बाद भी challenge hai. There is one thing that goes beyond our heavenly body. So, kya cheez hoti hai, what is this thing? So, we talk of say, religion. So, Gita Janeshi and Bhagavad Gita, we try to see this with time, but the intellectual soul hai, Gita ke jo crux hai. We hai ye chala ki swami hoga ki nanam sastani siddhanti nanam dahati paoga and hum ne uska kya tha ki nath nathi shushuti bhavta ki kitna hota hai isko to usse kya hai ki ek aisi cheez hai jo hamare shareer se jaati hai to us cheez ko to dekhna bada mushkil hai as a doctor as a scientist hum the ways are experiment we need to honestly soul ko measure karne ke liye karne ke if these are you know more sudden you know heat will see and but real life mein hum dekhte hain to jo ek hamari apna hai वो तो नॉर्मली वेयर लाइक में हम लोग उस टाइम और जो है किसी ओरिएंट करते हैं तो कहीं ना कहीं से कुछ ना कुछ अंश हमारा जो है एक दुनिया में बसता है तो दैट इज यू नो रियल थिंग सेकंड जो एस्पेक्ट है सर जो आदि व्हिच इज अगेन नेक्स्ट वाला फ्रॉम फ्रॉम द टॉपिक कि जो 60-70 ईयर्स का गैप हमारे पास है अभी दैट गैप इज ऑलरेडी अराउंड 40-50 ईयर्स का यूपी यूएस में भी है कहाँ का गैप है फ्रॉम से बैच ऑफ बैच ऑफ एंड व्हेन आई से इट्स काइंड ऑफ यू सिस्टमली बट बैच ऑफ कौन सा जहाँ पे हम लोग काम कर रहे हैं साइंटिस्ट एंड बैच ऑफ जहाँ पे आपको चीज़ें करने को मिलती है रियल लाइफ में तो बैच ऑफ का जो लैग है वो वर्ल्ड ओवर अराउंड 40-50 ईयर्स का रहता है तो सबसे पहला जो है जीपीएस बना था मैं समझता हूँ दैट वाज इन 1900s फ्रॉम गैप सबसे पहले किसने बनाया उसको डाटा जो है डिफरेंस एंड रिसर्च ऑपरेशन रेवर इंफॉर्मेशन इन यूएस तो सबसे बड़ा डिफरेंस सबसे बड़ा जो है एक रिसर्च बजट उन्हीं के पास होता है तो जीपीएस से लेके मोबाइल फोन से लेके ये वो कंप्यूटर से लेके सारी की सारी चीजें पहले वहां बन जाती है और इनिशियल 30-40 ईयर्स तक इंफॉर्मेशन इज क्लासिफाइड सो यू कैन नॉट दैट नेवर कम्स अप व्हेन द इंफॉर्मेशन इज रिलीज्ड इन द पब्लिक डोमेन देन व्हाट हैपेंस टू पीपल दे स्टार्ट यू नो काइंड ऑफ रेप्लिकेटिंग द थिंग्स And initially, when any technology comes, it's very, very expensive. So, which is a very important thing, which we try to learn a lot of people think it's a kind of bottleneck, the main thing is cash everything. But if you put that when the technology comes, and lots of people, they start working on that technology, the price, the industry drives the price down slowly. And a joke, our computer may, I think you can buy a laptop, even in, say, it doesn't have to be 12,000 without the laptop. Initially, the computer same, basically, it was, almost impossible to afford the computer. Now coming to the main point which I am trying to drive home is the other of technology we have and also people ask and I think Ashima to mention this thing as well the I look younger than I am. So I think that is something I have been trying to the idea ki kya cheez aisi hai, can we extend the lifespan, can we slow the aging, can we fall the aging, can we reverse aging. So that is a kind of a big question everybody thinks and lots of people think. I would like to share my insight on that, it can change and I think that I've been doing a few things. So, सबसे important चीज़ है आज आप देखते हो कि cells and research जैसे especially these guys are doing and other research which is especially in molecular level. So, we have started finding the cause कि हम वेज क्यों करते हैं. I think lots of you guys know probably telomere जो होता है, the length of telomere decreases as with the division. And that is one thing which is very rudimentary. But now we are kind of reached to a stage कि जहाँ पे हमें पता है कि एक्चुअली एजिंग में क्या प्रॉब्लम हो रही है तो एजिंग इज बेसिक ऑप्शन इन्फॉर्मेशन तो हमारी जो वी आर नॉट बॉर्न टू डाई इन वन वे कि दैट इज अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग इन्फॉर्मेशन व्हिच हैज बीन कमिंग अक्रॉस विद रीसेंट रिसर्च एंड आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट पार्ट ऑफ रिसर्च व्हिच इज हैपनिंग इन थ्री लैबोरेटरीज बट कमिंग टू द क्लिनिकल एप्लीकेशन एज वेल तो वी आर नॉट बॉर्न टू डाई बेसिकली आवर सिस्टम इज माय फंक्शंस एंड स्लोली बेसिकली इट डिटेरियरेट्स And what happens to that basically, because every time the DNA is the basis of our life. Practically speaking, DNA and the protein synthesis and we have to take the translation of such tablet with it. उसको हम जितना परफेक्टली हमारी बॉडी करती जा रही है उतना ही हम लोग बेसिकली यंग हैं उतना ही हम लोग ज़्यादा दिन जा रहे हैं और होता क्या है कि एक तो आपका डी एन ए क्योंकि डी एन ए से इम्पोर्टेंट चीज़ क्या होती है ईपी जीनोम ईपी जीनोम की कॉन्सेप्ट अभी 30-40 years की होगी लेकिन नोबडी न्यू द एग्जैक्ट फंक्शन ऑफ ईपी जीनोम होता क्या है तो हिस्टोन प्रोटीन्स होते हैं बेसिकली व्हाट दे डू दे रेगुलेट द डी एन ए सो डी एन ए क्या करता है दस वक्त पर लेकिन सर अपने आप में सिग्नल्स होते हैं दैट इज डिलीवर्ड बाय हिस्टोन्स हिस्टोन प्रोटीन्स यूजिंग वैरायटी ऑफ टेक्निक्स एंड मेथड्स तो होता क्या है कि सो मेनी टाइम के साथ साथ बेसिकली आर एंटीजन है रिस्पॉन्स है बेसिकली दे बिकम अनकॉम्पैक्ट अनकॉम्पैक्टिव हो जाते हैं एंड व्हाट हैपेंस इज दैट इंफॉर्मेशन इज स्लोली यू नो इट इज ट्रांसफर बट इट इज यू नो एज एक्यूरेट एज इट कुड बी होता क्या है कि उससे हमारी जो डिफरेंट पार्ट्स हैं बॉडी की दे स्टार्टेड मैलफंक्शनिंग तो पहली चीज तो क्या है कि डीएनए की मैलफंक्शनिंग स्टार्ट हो गई तो उसके प्रोसेस होते हैं प्रोसेस क्या है वन प्रोसेस एक्वायर्ड प्रोसेस एंड अदर प्रोसेस आर Now it's a very well established technique. Few things which I would like to share with you. The number one is something from Sundeep Mishra that fasting is one thing. So fasting is magic. So basically what it does basically, it gives you know, positive stress to your body. So पहले तो जो है काफी लंबे में fasting को करते हैं. लेकिन too much of you know, fasting can be counterproductive. But fasting once a week, twice a week even, that is good. And now our concept of intermittent fasting has come. So intermittent fasting क्या होता है? You basically you know don't eat very regularly and skip a meal a day and that will help you burn around 30-40% of the calories which you would like to normally you take and that you know that is gives a positive stress to your body and that is a very clear that you know role in that role. Second is you know exercise. So of course gym going and any kind of exercise right now which pushes you beyond your in your boundaries. तो इफ द रिक्वायरमेंट इज कि इफ यू फॉर द जिम अगर अपने पैरों पर चल के आप ऑफिस आ रहे हो तो इतनी सारी एक्सरसाइज नहीं की अच्छे से तो दिस इज काइंड ऑफ एन एक्सट्रीम आई एम सेइंग बट यू हैव टू रिड्यूस गिव योर बॉडी दैट काइंड ऑफ स्ट्रेस इट इज ऑलवेज मेकिंग दैट वे आई नीड टू बी यू नो पार्ट लाइक अ बैक सिचुएशन सो दैट इज सेकंड थिंग एंड द थर्ड थिंग इज व्हिच इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट अवॉइडिंग ऑफ स्मोकिंग ड्रिंकिंग दैट गोस विदाउट सेइंग दैट इज यू आल्सो दैट गिव्स यू आल्सो the free radicals which that makes your body age faster than it would be. And next thing is cold really. So the temperature has got a very you know big say correlation with your aging process. So the colder the environment is, the slower the aging would be. And now the victim has some also people they might know the ice cold shower within the belly below or up here. So ice cold shower that is also kind of you know it helps a lot. It basically slows down your body aging, mainly one way. So that these are the main things you know I can probably drink water. Water is very very healthy for the body. If you drink water and concept like how much water you need, people they say 3 liters a day. Drinking practically having around 12 liters a day. And that is you know I don't know there is a limit or not, but that is something I practice you know I've been practicing for the rest of my life really. तो उसका क्या होता है कि मोर वाटर ड्रिंक यू हैव टू गो यू डू एवरी यू एवरी नाउ एंड अगेन बट दैट इट विल वॉश योर टॉक्सिन्स बिफोर दे एक्युमुलेट सो द कांसेप्ट इज बेसिकली यू नीड टू वॉश द टॉक्सिन्स बिफोर दे एक्युमुलेट सो हियर द थिंग्स एंड लास्ट थिंग आई वुड लाइक टू यू नो शेयर विद यू इज इंटरेस्टिंग फैक्ट कि आपको मालूम है कि दुनिया में सबसे ज्यादा लंबे और सबसे ज्यादा जो ये करने वाले लोग कौन से थे कौन से कंट्री में थे कौन से कंट्री होगी भाई Any guesses? Japan, Japanese are Chinese, Russians. So, India is the country. You won't even believe. India may the longest living people they live in India. Who come here? Not in North India, not in the rest of India. It's a particular tribe that lives in, you know, in the foothills of Himalayas. And उस tribe के लिए कहते हैं कि वहाँ पे if you see them practically even 80-year old female will be resting in 30s and that is a very you know big group and even if 75-80 year old women they be children so these you know so basically it's not you know only in genetics India में हम लोग जबकि ऐसा नहीं है but if you see lifestyle that you know this is from Gurugram tribe so if you can Google Gurugram H-U-N-Z-A Gurugram tribe They are the longest living people on the earth and also the youngest living people on the earth. So, who is the tribe here? You can see the habits. So, who is the tribe here? Who is the tribe here? So, they do basically, you know, they walk for at least 8-10 miles a day. That is their routine. They, you know, take the ice water, which is the border of Indian Pakistan. So, intra-track quality looks from morning for a day and then morning, and then basically they will take ice cream shower every day, and they eat less, only 2 meals a day. So, these are the main things. So, with these words, I'd like to, you know, say thanks to Dr. Mehra again for coming all the way, and hope I have shared some insights with you which will be helpful in your life. Thank you very much for all the rest.
Thank you, sir. Big round of applause for our director, Dr. Pankaj Singh, sir. Thanks for sharing the secret of being here. And we look forward to the centenary celebration also in the university. Big round of applause for our grand managing director, Dr. Pankaj Singh, sir. And now, the legend, Pankaj Singh, we are here. Before calling the legend, I'd like to give a brief account of Dr. Now he is most known as the ex-dean research of AIIMS New Delhi. He was also the ex-professor and the founding chair of the Department of Transplant, Immunology and Immunogenetics at AIIMS New Delhi. And holds Dr. C.G. Pandit, National Chairs of ICMR at Alumni Experimental Sciences New Delhi. Sir, he was also the founding president of the Federation of Immunological Societies of Asia Oceania, FIMSE. And presides over the Human Society of Physical Compatibility and Immunogenetics. Sir sits on the National Board of Advisors of the Sector of Stem Cell Science and the Advisory Board of Interest Foundation and is a trustee of the Board of Immunology Foundation. Sir, a keen academician researcher, which he is the recipient of the prestigious H.J. Mehta Gold Medal and the Shakunta Abhichan Prize of the ICMR. And Shanti Chalupatnagar Prize, one of the highest Indian science awards from CSIR. Sir, it's an honor and a privilege to have you among us. A big round of applause for the legendary Professor Dr. N.K. Mehra. I'd like to invite him to deliver a lecture on evolution of transplantation immunology with special focus on the solid organ transplant. A big round of applause again for Professor Dr. Mehra, sir.
Which I passed by many times while going to that work, but this is the first time I had the opportunity to come inside. And I'm so glad to be standing here in this beautiful auditorium, and all the students very disciplined in their aprons and all. It's something that we won't see nowadays as much in AIIMS as I'm seeing it here. People called Dr. Pankaj Singh, your director, as a young director. I found him dynamic as well. I also called your Vice-Chancellor young as well, because I have seen Sundeep for very many years, actually 18 decades. I've seen him as a young man as well, so I still see that he's a young fellow. And you have actually brought a garment from AIIMS over there, and I'm sure under its stewardship, this institution will do extremely well. I thought I would speak to you a little bit about the evolution of transplant immunology and how I came into this meeting. I just came by chance. It was only the early 70s that in the institute, the names, we were trying to understand the immunology of leprosy. You know, in the 70s, leprosy was very prevalent in India. Already 10 to 12 million cases of leprosy around the world, or 5 to 6 million used to be in India. So I used to put this central part of India, Wardha, in Maharashtra state. And in Wardha, we used to go to the villages to see village after village afflicted with leprosy. Families, large families, separate children, all living in maybe one or two room huts, and only two or three people would be affected. how does that help me? Well, we were thinking in terms of looking into genetic factors. What is it that controls that some children develop factors and others don't? Although they're living under the same environmental and social conditions there. And from there, we went to the field of HLA vaccine, and then, of course, we have a look back and got drawn into the whole field of organ transplantation. I spent all my life at this very institute. I entered here in 1969 and was out for there in 2014, but then again, I was there for 5 years as a national chair. So let me briefly talk to you about how the organ transplant is monitored. And most of the times, it is the kidney transplantation. So let me talk to you a little bit about solid organ transplantation as that. And organ transplantation, of course, is a medical procedure in which the damage of the disease organ often the recipient is replaced by either knee. And you can do it by autograft, like you do in the skin graft, or an allograft. Allograft is the one that we mostly do. And most of the successful organs that we transplant now are 7. The transplant kidney, liver, lungs, heart, pancreas. And of course, the other day you read the news that in AIIMS we gave up to the lung transplant. Worldwide, of course, kidneys are the most commonly transplanted organs. And the donor could be living, of course, for the kidney, or the liver, it could be a living donor. But for the heart, of course, the donor has to be a granddad, bleeding heart. But for the transplant to succeed, the immunological barrier will have to be. Because anything that you transplant from outside, the body's immune system will react to it and lead to the outcomes. Now, this is in a one slide in summarizing landmark developments that took place in the last century in understanding host immunity, and in particular the host immunity to organ transplant. You know, in the 90s, I must say that when I joined the institute, in 1969, we used to have a very small library there. And in the library, there was a book called The Lymphocytes. It was written by a guy from the University of Oxford, Yorkshire. And the book was only on lymphocytes. You only said there is a small lymphocyte, there is a medium-sized lymphocyte, there is a large lymphocyte. And somewhere the book also said that the lymphocyte is an end cell. And today, you know, the lymphocyte is the most probably the most important cell in the body. They called it end cell at that time, because at that time you did not even have the electron microscope, leave aside the scanning electron microscope. You only have the light microscope, there's only the light microscope, and I'm sure my friend from pathology would appreciate that the lymphocyte looks like a small lymphocyte, looks like a dark round cell. Nucleus all over, very little control of the cytoplasm. The cytoplasmic organelles are very few. And any cell where the cytoplasmic organelles are few, you think it's a non-functional cell. And therefore, people call it the end cell. But you know, over the century, you can see there was understanding of the importance of lymphocytes in immunity, the description of the delayed and hypersensitivity in the response. But in 49, this guy Burnett, he was then called the son of McFarland Burnett, he published a theory of self versus long self. Anything that is long self, it could be a virus, or bacteria, or a parasite, or fungus, any infection, or a mismatched transplant organ, is transplanted, but they suggested clonal selection to explain fetal or immune tolerance. And then, of course, the whole field started from Richard Borer in 1936, trying to transplant or trying to change skin grafts in various strains of mice. And they found that there is a phenomenon called the transplant agents. And in the 1950s, we had a little bit of understanding of the circulation, the recirculation of the lymphocytes from blood to lymph and back to lymph. And then, of course, the 40s and 60s decades, there was again an understanding of tolerance, immunological tolerance. Even today, we have not been able to achieve immunological tolerance. But then, Medawar and Bird, who Bernard got the Nobel Prize because of their back work in 1960, and then came 1980, when Sell, Dossel, Dossel, and Zink and others, who described for the first time the existence of what we call today the matrix compared with the complex, the MNC as we call it, which in the humans is called as the HLS external, which actually governs the success of transplant. Now, MNC was primarily discovered because of me, you know, in transplant. And of course, very simple stories, we will talk to you some other time, how it really came out. So this was the first organ transplant done, first kidney transplant done in Boston on December 23, 1954. This is 4 years prior to the discovery of the HLA system in man. HLA system was discovered in 1950. What the surgical at that time trying was to see if they could exchange an organ from one human body to the other. And they had this model and the twins. First successful kidney transplant, identical twins, Ronald Herrick to Ron Herrick, there's a Ron to Richard, and that now succeeded for 9 years. It was within the head of the twins. But this story is even more important. This is the story of what we call 19-year-old twins. They were again this monozygous twins, identical twins. Maybe this girl at that time in 1960, 14 years of age, Johanna. Johanna Nightingale, they didn't give the name of the Nightingale girls, and she's playing the doll that was given to him by Kennedy. And she was lucky to have a sister who was identical. The transplant was done, and this kidney transplant functioned for more than half a century, 50 years or so. This is a picture in 2011, a transplant was done in 1960. You cannot differentiate between who is the donor and who is the recipient. Now, this was a challenge to the immunologists. If the identical sibling transplant can function that long, we need to devise ways and means of how we can understand host immunity, question the host immunity, and make sure that the graft can function. This is from where the research came. And today we have two challenges. Even if you find a donor, even if you find your mother or father is willing to give a kidney or be able to do, still there are two challenges. And these challenges are true for any sort of organ transplant, but whenever I'm talking about the data here, it is mostly from the kidney transplant. One challenge is of matching for the genes. And the other is even more important, that is antibodies. Characterization of antibodies. Are these antibodies, and you have now learned during the pandemic the important role of antibodies there. HLA genes are very polymorphic. The difference between blood groups and HLA is the polymorphism. Blood groups, you have only A or B or APO or the AB. And here, the possibility that my profile of HLA genes will be similar to yours, theoretically, there is only 1 in 1 billion. Which means a lot of the certain reasons to tell me that the HLA system has been developed prior to hostility to the transplant surgeons. If they're unable to find this, it will be a tumor from the population. In recent years, the technology has advanced. Something that we used to do in the 1970s, and if, by the way, the first kidney transplant done in AIIMS was in 1975, I was a student at that time. And that was the time when we were playing around with immunology and electricity, but then I got drawn into this field because the surgeon at that time, Dr. Dhawan and others, were very keen that somebody, some experts should get trained and all that. It's a good way, we had no money, had no microscope and all that. But this long bridge, so go ahead and do it. And now, of course, from that time to today, our ability to define HLA genes, or you can say HLA alleles. Earlier we used to call them as HLA antigens, but now we call them HLA alleles because you can do the DNA based testing. They were all significantly primarily in the NGFs, the next generation sequencing. And that has really opened up the field a lot. And there have been great advances of, and everybody is okay. The second challenge, as I said, is antibodies. Introduction of luminance-based solid phase assay systems using beads covered with single LED has been a singular significant development. We cannot define what we call donor-specific antibodies. That is the one that would actually lead to the protection of the graft. And there are limitations to the antibody testings that we have now. The field is developing so very fast. And it is all due to the tremendous international cooperation that we have in this field. And every 3 to 4 years, we have what we call international disciplinary workshops, where laboratories from around the world actually come forward and change their data. Look at this data of 1978 by Karasaki. Karasaki used to be in the UCLA in Los Angeles. And really a pioneer, he's unfortunately dead now. And these are the three types of transplants that have been compared. Donors that are HLA identical cells, and we'll be talking to you later on. How do we find out an HLA identical sibling in the family if somebody is sick? But the parent child transplants are very common. In fact, in India, more than 80% of the organ transplants that we go for kidney are at the parent child. And again, their mother is the donor more often than the father. And we are fine. Father is the breadwinner and things like that. Our challenge is again on cadaver donor transplant, what we now call diseased donor transplant. A road traffic accident, a young man dying due to a road traffic accident and had a head injury. And there comes the role of Dr. Pankaj Singh. The Vice Prof with the Immunology who declared brain death. And the brain death law was passed only in India in 1994. And after 1994, there have been changes in all of that, 3 or 4 kind of changes. But we could now define brain death individual as technically dead and a beating heart individual for brain death and take the organs from there. By the way, if you look at the half life, the transplant. HLA half-life is 34 years. The half-life means time at which at least half the graft is still functioning. And parent child is about 11, and the cadaver donor transplant for 7.5 years because they're not very well matched. Now, if you think of the situation, the young man, 25 years of age, he needs a kidney transplant. Our effort must be to find out a donor who's fully matched. Of this as closely as we can, or what we have now identified the critical alleles that have to be matched, otherwise the antibodies, antibodies, and antibodies. And this was earlier, but now 1987 to 95. Then you can see the decade of 96 to 2006. By the way, 1983 has been a landmark year, but that is the year when the calcineurin inhibitor like the cyclosporine was first time used as an immunosuppressive agent for organ transplantation. But then we know that cyclosporine A is associated with nephrotoxicity. Now we have a whole bunch of drugs that can be used as immunosuppressive agents. But what this slide is saying is that the difference in half-life of from HLA identical grafts to the diseased donor graft, or the poorly matched diseased donor graft, has remained the same, even after the advent of those very powerful immunosuppressive drugs. Half-life has not been changed, the difference there, which means it highlights the point that HLA matching is associated with long-term survival, which is very clear. If you, rather than taking donors only from the family, these are our diseased donor transplant, where we match for HLA A, B, and the PR, what we mentioned for 6 antigens there, or 6 alleles there, or 2 in HLA A, 2 in B, and 2 in PR. You can see that the receiving donor pairs, which are 0 mismatched, have a better graft survival and those who are in missing for 5 or 6 years. Animal immunity hooks to me with one which drives this rejection. And this is a nuance. One is the T cell mediated rejection, which can be largely taken care of because we have very effective immunosuppressive drugs, and the T cell mediated rejection can be controlled through the cell, you want to do it with the intestine. Our problem is with the antibody mediated rejection, what we call AMR, some people call it ADMR, antibody mediated rejection. And then there's an acute phase, and there's a chronic phase. Acute is still of low frequency now because of those really powerful immunosuppressive drugs. Our problem still remains is the chronic aftermath. We don't want the organ after all that trouble that we've taken of finding a donor, choosing a donor, and the transplant is done, that we don't want the organ to go. And this is still chronic, we may not say a problem due to the occurrence of what we call HLA-specific, donor-specific antibodies. Antibodies which are directly to the mismatched donor antigens of alleles. And the other is that post-transplant is development of what we call de novo development of donor-specific antibodies, the DNPs. And there are other issues there which I may not have time to talk to you about, the role of non-HLA antibodies as well. So, we wrote this paper a few years ago in the modern era of immunosuppression. The question was, should we revisit HLA matching to improve long-term outcome? So, we looked into a lot of papers on the world, including our own AIIMS, and we found that the good HLA match, if you have a donor recipient matched really well, good HLA match is associated with lower rates of sensitization. Lower dosages are required for the immunosuppressive drugs, and they will lower risk for what we call de novo antibody development post-transplantation. That's a big challenge for us. And therefore, matching definitely improves the graft survival. This is also clear from this data from the collaborative transplant study in Germany. They had the CTS group, which actually takes data from around the world, various transplant trials around the world. And here you can see again the data that I showed you earlier. It's a hand-cut sibling transplant or a one haplotype match. By the way, the kidneys that we exchange from parents to the children are actually matched for half the genes because you got half the code of genes from the mother and the half from the father. And we call it a haplotype match for only one haplotype. And the disease will remain the same thing. What is more important for you? This study indicates that the anti-rejection therapy ARD needs are significantly higher if you have a HLA mismatch transplant. So the best is to have HLA mismatch transplant. If you have a mismatch transplant, you don't even need them more of immunosuppressive drugs and anybody that associated with all kinds of problems of bone fractures and things like that, and many other problems that you have to go with. So our effort should be to find a match. Now, we have used this word HLA for you, actually the human leukocyte antigens, part of the MHC, which was developed way back in 1958, and these are the three guys who sort of worked on, Brossay in the center from France. We had a very simple study at that time, in 1954. He spoke on the all rounds. And he argued that patients were given multiple blood transfusions. They must wear the antibodies. Because the blood is coming from the third party source. And that was true. It turned out to be. And then there was a Dutch guy, Dutch scientist on the road. He argued that if multi transfused people can raise antibodies, multi-parent women should also raise antibodies. Because after all, the half the genes within the child and the parent are coming from the father. And that of course on the Boston on the work in the state grounds in the house and in the early 70s, that was in 1972, first time indicated that the body has what we call immune response genes, and these vary from one individual to the other, and they are the ones which are sort of recognized and called antigens. So this is in a very simple post-hoc type of slide showing that normally the set of chromosome 6 genes called the HLA 58, the major function was the chromograph function. Later on, in 1973, of course, Gurugram in Guy's Hospital in London, first time showed that HLA 327 is so very strongly associated with antigen spontaneous. And that opened up a new sort of field of HLA disease associations. But the HLA system was primarily developed because of the need and organ and bone marrow transplantation, and as I said, extraordinary polymorphisms. And this is the polymorphism, we're talking about class 1 genes, class 2 and class 3 genes, but there are several. The whole lot, you know, this whole analogous error and the division of the short arm of the chromosome is filled with genes. The ones that we match for are the ones that we've shown in the circle, the ABC of the class 1. We don't even match for C for organ transplant, but we prove that for the whole organ transplant. And class 2 we have the DL and the DQ. And the function, significance of class 1 and class 2 is very different. It's a very wonderful dichotomy of function that the class 2 molecules there present foreign peptide. The COVID-19 peptide have to be first time presented to the immune system of the host in association with the class 2 molecules, the DR or the DQ. But the mildly derived antigens in the body, the internally derived antigens, they are presented on the microbiome. And they have been seen by the cytotoxic T-cell in association with the MSC1, the class 1 genes. So there's a clear dichotomy of functions. Okay, so what does HLA do? Why is it so important? Important because they present peptides, foreign peptides, and they could be pathogens, or they could be mismatched antigens to the T-cells. And as I said, exogenous, externally derived antigens are presented, all of them, in association with the HLA class 2 onto the CD4 T cell. And the internally derived antigens are presented to the CD8 T cell. I wrote this book in 2010. I brought it for a library. I will present it after my talk to the Vice-Chancellor. So this is, in general, the function, because unless you understand the functions of these HLA 1 and 2, you will not appreciate what you image. And you can see that very clearly the CD4 T7 is right in the middle there. It's like a headwater cell. It controls and helps the functions of B cells on one hand and of the cytotoxic T cells on the other. And the HLA class 2 presenting the bacteria, viruses, or mismatched transplant antigens. To the CD4 T cell. CD4 T cell is the first cell which sees anything that is normal cell, and then comes into the virus. I really don't want to go into details of this, but I think this is sufficient for this group over here of students. The two other things that you must understand in allo recognition is what is called a direct allo recognition and an indirect allo recognition. Direct is where the T cell of the host recognizes unprocessed allogenic MHC molecule on graft APC. We are putting kidney, and the kidney has the antigen cells. These are recognized by the host T cells. So this is a direct allo recognition. The other is indirect, where presentation of processed peptides of allogenic MHC molecule bound to the self, the internal self, and I say, one is on the donor, other is on the self. So one is associated with acute rejection there, and the other is associated with the CR. And if you go into the depth of this, you really understand why does the AR take place over at the CR place. And how do we sort of improve that? How does this whole thing lead to activation of aerobic cells? But we want to make sure that the activation of the cytotoxic T cells does not take place, because if that happens, it goes on to sort of damage the organ the organs are put. And most of the times, these cells also have the B cells to make antibodies. Now, over the years, there have been technological advances in HIV. As I said, during the 70s and 80s, when I just first started my real scientific career, was in 1976, and I joined a lecturer in AIIMS in 1979, and we were running up and down, really excited that multi-kidney transplants would take place, and you know, there was such a beautiful teamwork between hematologists and the surgeons and us, and therefore, and we used to, three of us, the three teams who were unique all the time. But you can see over the years, serologists almost no more are used in the labs. And that means the RFLP, the PCR-based testing, they just live there. But everybody is now talking about the NGS, the next generation sequencing, for detection of these genes, the alleles and the polymorphism. And now you can separate the alleles there. And your terminology has changed a lot. This is the way we now write the HLA molecular HLA. And this is a model of us, because you have two alleles in A and two in B and two in the D, but one each has come from the mother and the other has come from the father. You can see that the HLA matching prevents the induction of monospecific antibodies and will improve the graft survival. And that's what we know so far from hundreds and thousands of transplants that have been done around the world. But the number of HLA proteins known in data is so high. You see that, and this is a slide that was made in 2019. I'm sure that on the slide will happen to be revised. That the number of alleles in each of these locus are very high. And when we do a mathematical calculation, we will find that there is different. You know, the possibility that I will match with you is about 100 million chances. So, this kind of polymorphism means that many patients will get transplanted with an HLA mismatch. And we do that every year. The good thing is that not every HLA mismatch gives you antibody formation. We need to therefore identify those alleles that are associated with graft loss, others that are not. So that's the kind of thing that is going on now. The big question is, which patients will do well and which not? Do we have any biomarkers? So all kinds of, all sides research will have to be done to find out. The challenge for us is identification of non-immunogenic HLA mismatches. Mismatches that are not immunogenic, that do not lead to the formation of antibodies, and therefore those even in mismatch transplant would do that. This is a family pedigree there. You can get the mother, the father, and four different kind of children can be there as per the Mendelian segregation rule. If the individual first is you, how likely you are to find a family match? Your sibling one would be a HLA identical sibling for you, but that's only 1 in 4 chance. But there's a 1 in 4 chance that your sibling for you to be totally unidentical. You can be aware of taking an unidentical donor as a first one. But the sibling 2 and 3 would match for one haplotype with you. That you share the same haplotype with you are the mother or the father. So siblings, at least half of them would be HLA haploidentical, like the mother or father. This is what we do all the time for selection of the own family, at least for the clinical side. So we know now, and I want to not focus primarily on antibodies. Antibodies is a good problem. Antibodies cause coming out loss in solid organ transplantation, and there's the role of anti-HLA antibodies, as I said, preformed donor-specific antibodies, de novo pathogenic donor-specific antibodies, or it could be the role of non-HLA antibodies. The whole field of antibodies has really expanded so much that we now have to really talk to our nephrology colleagues, cardiology colleagues, how to make desensitization. We need to remove antibodies or remove or make sure that the title of these antibodies goes down before we deal with the transplant start. What would these antibodies do? As you can see here, the antibodies adhere to the epithelium, damage results in everything else. Proliferation, printing or thickening, and the thickening becomes so much that there's a rapid bacterial circulation in context. So that will be true in the process. I again hope this book, anybody has provided a draft for your draft of components, all of the draft solutions for the frontiers in immunology, July 2017. I brought one copy of that to the community of Chancellor of the library. Now, each antibody scores graft failure in renal transplantation. This is also not becoming very clear in heart as well as in liver transplantation. But there are a number of issues and concerns that we need to answer. The peripheral blood cells, the big concept of that, they contain 9 blood cells and memory blood cells. We've heard about the memory blood cells, it may be important in the memory as well. Each and antibody is a cause antibody mediated rejection are mainly used by the memory cells. We need to somehow find the quantity of memory cells that the patient has prior to the transplant. But we don't have a test yet. We have a very good quantitative test to define that. So unlike the in vitro T cell assays that are normally used to control a T cell mediated rejection, primary cultures of B cells are so therefore, we have to depend on interpretation of current donor-specific antibody findings that we have in the lab, which is challenging, and this includes all of these. So that's our job is to find out our challenges to find out pathologic versus inert donor-specific antibody. Not all antibodies are bad, but we have no way to find out which antibodies are bad and which antibodies are pathologic. And we need to monitor with our post-transplant. I think earlier in the 70s and 80s, our dog used to finish. We used to sit with the transplant team. Our dog is finished. We run the HLA back. We found the donor for you. And we run the cross-match retransplant. And you know, it is not that. We say, okay, I'm wrong. Our dog is done. And today, the laboratory dog begins. Because you need to really do the monitoring of the birds post-transplant. And this is the antibody production pathway from the memory cells, which are located in the secondary organs and in the circulation. And they really encounter with the same antigen, and they turn into plasma cells. So the B cells turn into plasma cells. Plasma cells make antibodies. Is the plasma cells will make antibodies? There are a lot of people who report an immune process. When there are long memory B cells, why does the antibody titers go down? Because the plasma cells are alive. Plasma cells after 5 or 6 months senesce, they die off. So therefore the antibody levels die off. But in this case, the antibodies will remain. And we need to test these antibodies. The various tests that we have in that. At least the three very important tests that we do is a CDC, is a complement dependent cytotoxicity assay, or the flow cross match, or more importantly, what we now do. It's a solid phase assay, a luminance-based antigen assay, which can identify for us an elite specific against one donor allele of the donor antibody or not. And there are several other issues that are shown on this slide. So these are on the luminance-based tests, we really have high-grade tests that we do. And this is what we do day in and day out for our colleagues in immunology and in the surgical team. But I'm glad in the last 3 or 4 years, even the cardiac team and the liver teams are coming forward. But they also want to understand that either the pre-graft study or the post-graft study, are there any possibilities of antibodies and particularly the immunosuppressive. We did a study sometimes ago when I was still in Maine, it was published in 2014 or something in IGMR, and we compared these three tests, the luminance-based tests with the CDC test and the flow over there. And that was the study that was done. Don't know who again details of that. All that trying to understand that the luminance-based screening is a very highly sensitive test. The flow, when the flow cytometry came, we were very happy because the flow cytometry was at least 100 times more sensitive than the separate cells and not the group. The group has great cells, it's even more sensitive. Sometimes it is unnecessarily very, very highly sensitive. And we found out even the difference between what happens if you do a full cross match or for this PVC cross match. Compare that to the luminance-based fluorescence test over there, and look at the mean fluorescence intensity, taking that as a mean, which is the data trying to indicate, and this is not clear. Most centers around the world use MFI of 1,000, and even some of them have come down to 500. Earlier, when we had begun, people were talking about 2,000 or 3,000. Anyway, and then there are all these guidelines that have been published in the American Journal of Transplantation, American groups also, sensitization in transplantation, assessment of risk. What would be the risk if, those are eight or nine situations over there, in terms of those three tests, the CDC, the flow, and the single antigen bleed test there, if they're positive or they're negative, or there's a history of sensitization, if the patient has already been given many blood transfusions. Or if it's a woman who has raised children, she broke some sensitized. And the HLA matching status there, or and if you have the HLA, So taking into consideration all of these factors over there, you can actually pre-transplant, calculate kind of risk. This is actually the way the field is now growing because we have identified that all luminally detectable antibodies may not develop and don't MRI to reduce the detected antibody titers. And there are a number of technical challenges in that. But one of the things which is very important is when we're talking about antibodies, not just simply antibodies are given to women, whether these antibodies are complement dependent, complement fixing, or non-complement fixing. But there has been tremendous development in the last 1 or 2 decades in terms of our selection of the donor strategy for and look at the tests that we do for C1Q in comparison to C3B assay over there, could be the complement binding antibody status. Again, our own studies indicating how relevant are the complement binding antibodies in the transplantation. The tests that are available to us are, as I said, the luminance, the same antibody breach, or the C1Q assay, C3B assay, or you can look at the IgG subgroups, IgG models, 2, 3, and 4. After all, G1 and G3 are known to be complement binding antibodies. And if you have the complement binding antibody, they may or may not be allele specific to the donor, but they're bad. The complement binding antibody will always be bad. So, looking at these cases, I really don't want to go into details of this. This is a mother to child transplant down to heterodendrical cross match was found to be negative in CDC and in flow. So the luminance showed a very high titer antibody, and eventually we found that this graph had lost, that this guy had complement binding antibodies. Or in this case, of course, the C3B test was done, and the red bar there below shows that the complement binding antibodies are very low. So in this case, the graph eventually went up, which is a non-complement binding antibody. However, in the case I'm doing here, you see that the red bar is very high. This I had, this patient had complement binding antibodies. If you wanted to do all of these kind of tricks to select the food of the world of drugs. Okay, and now, folks, there's so much data on the clinical risk stratification of pediatric renal transplant recipients using either a C1Q test or a C3D fixing test for the enumeration of renal components of the antibodies. And the data is very essentially the same, more in favor of number one, complement binding antibodies are bad, and number two of those here, that the C3D test might be pretty better than the C1Q. And the meta analysis that we sort of looked into also indicated that the solid organ transplant recipients which circulating complement active anti-HLA donors designated for this experience statistically significantly increased risk of allograft loss and allograft rejection than the negative. So the message is not only the matching if it is a mismatch transfer, antibodies are likely to be there. And if the antibodies are there, detection of complement activity in the patient in solid organ transplantation adds value at an individual patient level for non-invasive biomarker virus stratification. You may not even need to do the biopsy or post-transplant. If you continue to do a regular post-mortem screening of antibodies, there is antibodies are the ones which are actually the cause of the transplant. But this is a sign which summarizes risk stratification based on the occurrence of BSA and the HLA competitiveness. You can see that if there are antibodies with BSA, the risk is very high. And if there are no antibodies, but the patient donor are mismatched, then you can see the second column over there, there is a standard risk. Because the mismatch, so therefore the possibility of a de novo development of the post are high. However, the question is if you have HLA matched, donors are even better. And you have already done the testing to prove that there are no bonus of antibodies in the pre-transplant stage. The risk is very low. The risk is low, nor need for giving them those high potent immunosuppressive drugs also is low. So therefore, that would be very useful in the long term if you were to need to be the second round. So I'm actually coming to the end of my talk, trying to highlight the point that the donor-specific antibody donor transplantation, solid organ transplantation, the question that still remains, why some transplant recipients who pre-transplant anti-HLA with BSA show a high transplant failure, but in others the same BSA do not come out? Are there any biomarkers? And people have really focused their attention on another biomarker, that you may be born with a certain biomarker that actually protects you from the drug loss. So if you assess the pre-transplant immune activation marker, number of markers that you know of, some of the negative contribution markers, the one study that we've done in AIIMS and other groups, that this could also be a very important biomarker there. And then there's some more. So, you know, there are still some unanswered questions that will remain in organ transplant. That is the role of non-HLA antibodies over there. Non-HLA antibodies is antibody against donor endothelial cells. And we found that kind of antibody has a more important role for the cardiologists who want to do a heart transplant. So the term non-HLA antibodies used in transplantation to describe autoreactive or alloreactive antibodies specific for targets other than the HLA. And most of these are commonly reported by the angiotensin 1, remitting antibodies, tubulin, LG2, collagen antibodies, and methyl, and those are the endothelial cells. We vary from one of the other. It depends on whether you're looking at heart or a pancreas or liver transplant. And this is shown here, for example, for the kidney, the non-HLA antibodies of the body, about one is the methyl gene, the MHC class 1 gene, the A gene, or the angiotensin type 2, or antibodies against the aberrant or the collagen type, and the heart, of course, the part of antibodies against the part of myosin, as well as the endothelial antibodies, lung, of course, antibodies to ECM, or antibodies to the epithelial cell. And similarly, there are other antibodies, IFF antibodies. So antibodies in general, our most important antibodies are the ones that we have already talked about, the HLA class 1 and H2 directed antibodies. So, in conclusion, my friends, just wanted to tell you that currently there are several options for antibody detection. Luminex basic antigen read testing being the most sensitive tool for us for assessing the immunological risk in solid organ transplantation, both for the HLA and non-HLA. However, there are intrinsic limitations of the test that it does not give you confidence in your form. So we need to have somebody who's really expert to have genetically damaging it. Although most sequences are very good decision making should be based on multiple tests rather than one single test. And broad-based knowledge about HLA, imagine cross-reactivity, epidotes, patients, in the history of all necessary correctly integrated data. And lastly, both clinical teams need to work closely as a team with experts in the transplant immunology or optimal management of patients before and after transplantation. Thank you very much, and I'm very happy to be here.
Knockout. So, would a HIV positive individual as a dectograph survivor? One, the number of kidney transplants done in HIV positive is really few. But even if they have to be done very carefully, because as you know, the CD14 is not done. They are already infected. You cannot give any more gene expression of that. So, very carefully, I would say monitoring the ground, monitoring antibodies, developing the right at least one, at least two. You know, in the first 3 months, what we do every time. But what we've seen is that change all the ground. I know of only 3 or 4 things that have been done in a very positive indication. I see that is high. That's the answer is like that. A person dying with a function of the ground was okay.
Because of ARC, it's written on that score of patient died. Last human patient for that one.
Yeah. There is one case that we know where the CCR5. The CCR5 delta 32, there is deletion there. And if you have the deletion in the HIV positive individual, the possibility of the virus from the individual is very low. So there are a lot of people we know who are born with the delta 32 in the CCR5 gene, and they are as professors at any of the years that they don't develop HIV. So we have also a few transplants that have been done.
The second question I want to ask is there any role of gamma ray radiation in the transplant as well? Because sometimes we can prevent, graft versus host disease using gamma ray radiation, and especially the blood transfusion. But I haven't seen any application of that in all the transplantations so far.
So that would be even the graft versus host disease or post versus graft disease. We talk mainly in excess CD.
And one last question is there any role if you are aware of CAR T? So like CAR T therapy is coming up, like, you know, it's very promising, it sounds like.
Yes. If COVID-19 has not come, we would all have been talking about CAR T cells and CAR NK cells today. And this is all part of what we call immunotherapy in cancer, glioma and other diseases. I'm also starting a company in India that is going to start manufacturing CAR T cells and CAR NK cells. And we'll be in touch with the company in America there, and they're trying to help us. So maybe it is, but as I was saying, if pandemic had not come, by now immunotherapy would have been most talked about topic. Maybe if I come next time, I will talk to you. This will talk about the immunotherapy. But this is the future, certainly. Chemotherapy, but then chemotherapy with body service or fire. CAR is what it is, whatever the cancer, any type of cancer, the chemistry transforms, and the HLA transforms in one thing, on the surface of the cancer cell is done. And once it is done, the B cell of the host fails to recognize that the cancer cell. So cancer keeps going. At one point, if the B cell is not going to die, this B cell will have to be brought back to the university over there, to the NIMS, and we make and we give what is called the chimeric antigen receptor, because it is the antigen receptor on the surface of the T cell that we recognize as a cell. So we give it a chimeric. And in addition to the T cell, there's a very important role of NK cells in the natural killer cells. A lot of people will ask me, I've been talking to you, my own name is NK. T-cells and B-cells, but my name is immunology, particularly for cancer, natural killer cells are very important. We are not ready to start anything.
Thank you. 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 whatever you have shown them, it will help in a great way going forward to them. Thanks a lot for taking up time, your precious time, and delivering this lecture on the evolution of transplantation immunology with a special focus on solid organ transplantation. Moving forward, moving ahead, we start with the stem cell process, and I'd like to invite first Mrs. Simi Singhji. She tell us why to donate these stem cells. She represents the Arjun Gate Foundation. Founded in 2017 in the memory of Arjun Gate, her son, who lost his battle to blood cancer in 2012. The Arjun Gate Foundation's endeavor is to find matching stem cell donors for all those in the need of stem cell transplantation. All patients suffering from various blood disorders, maybe a blood cancer, or other blood disorders like hypoplastic anemia, sickle cell anemia, or thalassemia, need to go through a stem cell transplant. But for this, the patient must find a fully matched HLA type blood donor. The chances of a patient finding a fully matched donor, even among his or her siblings, is only 25%, which means 75% of these patients have to find matches amongst unrelated voluntary donors through registries like AIIMS. The mission of our Germany Foundation is to educate and motivate the young people between 18 to 25 years in healthy population to volunteer as donors. And to tell you more about this, our Germany Foundation and why to donate stem cells, I'd like to invite Mrs. Simi Singh on stage to give her a round of applause.
And one and crossed the finish line before he himself crossed the line. So a belt hid him the gold medal, and iron was the silver medalist. So there was much new cry and murmurs in the audience. There was much human cry and there was a lot of murmurs in the audience, and people were shocked to see what was happening. And as typical, journalists got hold of Iron Fernandez after the race and they started questioning him. And they said, "But why did you do that? Why would you let a bell win? You could have won the gold medal." So Iron Fernandez turned around and he told them, he says, "No. He was the better man, and he was anyway going to win." They said, "No, but you could have won. The medal could have been yours." And he said, "What use would that money have been to me? What would my mother have thought of this victory? To me, the importance is not of winning the gold medal. The importance is of winning in life." And I thought this is a very beautiful story which all of us should always remember. And life will make us go through so many different experiences. And as we move on in life, you know, you will come to so many stages where you will have to make these choices. And who will make the better choice? And who will make the best choice are the ones who will be the most successful in the field. As it is, you all have chosen a very noble cause, but you will still come across these experiences where you will realize that giving is what really takes you to life. So the Academy Foundation, of course, works towards supporting the best fortunate. It is a given that in life, everybody is not dealt the same deck of cards. And there are some who are dealt a less fortunate deck of cards. And it is our endeavor to try and help these people. So we have people suffering from various kinds of blood disorders, may it be cancer, may be other genetic blood disorders like thalassemia. And there are 70 different types of blood disorders which can be treated with a stem cell transplant. We believe that the less fortunate ones need to be given a second chance of survival. A chance to beat the battle that they've been having to fight. Battle of life, making them believe that in today's world, being detected with one of these blood disorders is no longer a death sentence. Treatments are available, there is just not enough awareness. Most people have not heard of the BMT or the stem cell transplant, especially, you know, here you're all medical people, so you probably don't have. But when we go and talk to people in our universities or our institutes or even corporate offices, 9 out of 10 people do not know what a bone marrow transplant is or what a stem cell transplant is or what they can do. Organ transplants, solid organ transplants are now becoming a little bit more mainstream, so people have heard of it, but bone marrow transplants and stem cell transplants are still where people have very, very little awareness of. So, Arjun Vaisak was 24 years old when he was detected with ALL of the T cells. He was at that stage of life where he was raring to go in his career. He was one of those people who loved people, and people loved him. He was jovial, he was full of life. He had many dreams which he wanted to live with. And, you know, he was a good lawyer, he would write very well. But life came to a screeching halt for him at the age of 24. In fact, he had just been accepted into a university in the US to do his master's, and he got the news that he has leukemia. So instead of going to the US, he was taken to the hospital. In the 2 years that Arjun went through his treatment, sadly, finding fully typed HLA matches in India was not easy. There were very little facilities available, and there were hardly any donors registered in India as HLA type donors. So I think at that time there were barely, not even 12,000 donors registered in this entire country, where we have a population of over 1.3 million. So, it was a very difficult stage for him to accept that he was not finding a match easily. And actually what was bothering more was that the facility was not there to find the matches. And there were not that many transplant centers back then. And there was no one to guide you, there was no one to advise you as to how to go about trying to find a fully diagnosed HLA match. Like we already mentioned, that finding a match even within the family, a sibling match is only 25% chances. So how does one go about trying to find a match in this whole wide world? We were the fortunate ones. We could afford to take him to the US for treatment. We did find a match for him in the US. It had become too late by then, and things didn't go successfully, and things were not going to be the way we would have hoped them to be. However, in this interim period, while all this was going on, and we were trying to find a match for Arjun, and he was going through intensive treatment in the US, the one thing that always bothered me was that, and he would say to me, he said, "Mom, we can afford to come here. What happens to the thousands of people who can't afford to come to the US, who can't even afford treatment? How do they get treatment? Where do they get treatment?" You know, in the hospital, he would always be more worried about, oh, mom, that child in that room, you know, his mother is alone looking after him. She has to go home to cook for him. Can you make sure you bring food for him so that his mother doesn't have to go home, leave him alone? And, you know, you can bring the food for him from home so that his mother can stay with him. So that was the kind of person Arjun was. He was friends with every nurse, every cleaning person, every doctor in the hospital. In the evenings, it used to be quite a sight. We would enter his room and some nurse would be sitting with him and saying, "Arjun, I need to buy a new cell phone. Can you tell me which is the best one to buy?" Some doctor would be sitting with his laptop and telling Arjun, "Arjun, mera laptop keep nahi chal raha hai, isko zara please mere ko help kar de, kaise keep karna hai isko." So you know, he was friends with everybody. But the one thing that always bothered him the most was that where do other people who don't have the means get help from and get treatment? So in a way, Arjun had already laid the foundation for this foundation that I'm running today. It was something that he really wanted us to do. And I have to say, it took me 5 years after we lost Arjun to pick up the courage to be able to get emotionally stable. then we are all medical students, so you are already aware what stem cells are. But the stem cells, of course, are the most important cells that keep the balance in our bodies. They create our WBCs, our NCs, our immunity, platelets, all that is the job of the stem cells. Now, stem cell transplant. There are two types of stem cell transplants. You have the autologous transplant and you have the allogeneic. So in the autologous transplant, your own stem cells are used and the transplant is done. So there's a kind of cancers where an autologous transplant is required. An allogeneic transplant is when your own stem cells cannot be used and you need another person's healthy stem cells to replace your defective stem cells. And like I told you, siblings, only 25% chances that you will find a match with a sibling. So if you have four siblings, maybe one might be a match. But in today's day and age, where most families have only two children, maybe three, and now I think the younger generation don't even want to have a second child, most of them only want to have one child. So how are these people going to find matching stem cells? The chances of finding an unrelated stem cell match is 1 in 3. So how does one go about doing all this? Now, the stem cell, what we work is we collect HLA typings and we collect the database, and our database is then linked to the World Marrow Donors Association database. Now, the World Marrow Donors Association is a worldwide body where every registry that does this work, their stem cell HLA typed database is stored. So we are linked to this worldwide body, and if a doctor or a transplant center sends us HLA type reports of his patients that we are looking for matches, we get onto the World Marrow Donor Association database and we find matches through them for our patients at these transplant centers. Just to give you some information, now in India, there is so little awareness of this, and I think at the moment we have barely 500,000 registered donors. Now, just for some information that will put things into perspective, in America, 67% of the white Americans find matches, whereas less than 30% South Asians, Indians, Africans, and other ethnic groups find matches. The reason for this is because A, we are less aware, B, we have certain hesitations, we have certain taboos, and so 67% white Americans can go through their stem cell transplants, whereas less than 30% of the other communities can go through their transplants. There are some very hard facts which I'm going to just talk to you about. This is just to give you an understanding of how important it is to become aware and be a stem cell, register as a stem cell. Every 27 seconds, someone on this planet is being detected with a blood cancer. Every 27 seconds. Every 3 minutes, someone in the USA is being diagnosed with a leukemia, lymphoma, or a myeloma. Again, these are all blood cancers. Every 9 minutes, someone dies of blood cancer in the US. Now, I'm giving you statistics of the USA, but because in India there is so little statistics available. But India does have the third largest incidence of cancer. So India is not far behind. We have a very, very large incidence of cancer. 120,000 children in India are detected with lung cancer every year. That would mean 55 children a day. So you can understand the gravity of the situation. There are close to 40 million voluntary stem cell donors worldwide. 40 million registered stem cell donors worldwide. India has less than 0.03% of the population. We have the largest population in the world. We should be having the largest number of registered donors in the world. We should be supplying stem cells to the rest of the world. Now, best matches are of course found within the ethnicity. So if you save all our various Indian patients, it is best that we find matches within India. Now this will help not only the patients, but we, they will help patients of course to get through to their stem cell transplant, but we also bring down the cost of the stem cell transplant drastically. But the minute we have to bring stem cells from overseas, the costs go up at least 10 times. So it becomes very difficult for families to afford these transplants. Besides blood cancers, there are 70 different types of blood disorders which can be cured with stem cell transplants. We have thalassemia, which is, I think India has the largest incidence of thalassemia in the world. And the life of a thalassemic child is not pleasant. In fact, I think it is so difficult, not only for the child, but for the parents as well, where every 2 weeks, the child has to go for a blood transfusion. He has growth issues, we have so many other medical issues because of these transfusions. There are almost 15,000 thalassemic children born in India every year. Now, thalassemia can actually be controlled because if parents have their blood tests before they get married, they would be able to control thalassemia. But those who already, the children who are already born, the only way out is to go through stem cell transplant. So here is, I think, what I'm saying just explains by itself that why it is so important to be a registered stem cell donor. Have your way till it right and try and save somebody's life. You could be saving somebody's life in your own lifetime. You know, when we talk of organ transplant, a lot of the organ transplants, we're talking about brain dead people. So the burden of transplant comes on the parents or the family, the next of kin who have to take this decision. Here, you are the master of your own life. You're going to keep your stem cells while you are aware, you are alive, and it has no side effects. So, we will be explaining to you the entire process of how you can become a stem cell donor. It is a three-stage process where you will register, and we will take your HLA typing and put it in the World Marrow Donors Bank. And when we actually, when you're found to be a match to a patient, the second stage of donation, we will be explaining all that. So these are all very important reasons for you all, especially the young, to become stem cell donors. And my request to all of you would be to look into this, think about it, and do register as stem cell donors. I'll finish off with a very small story. Since you all are in the medical field, I hope this story will have an impact to you. So, 2 years ago, my husband and I had come to the US. traveling by road along the West Coast Highway, along the sea, and going northwards. And you have these very, very beautiful forests there called the Redwood Forest. Now, the speciality of the Redwood Forest is that the trees in the Redwood Forest, they grow to a height of about 300 feet. And their girth can be anywhere between 20 meters to 30 meters. So, and they're fascinating trees. So the naturalist who was showing us around, I asked him, my God, these trees are growing right on the shore, right along the coast, and California is so prone to earthquakes, the wind velocities here are so high. How is it these trees are standing here since the last 2,500 years? And I'm sure their root systems must be going really deep in. And he smiled and looked at me and he said, no ma'am, their root systems are not deep at all. So I was a little flabbergasted and I looked at him and I said, really? How can that be? And he says, the redwood trees have a very interesting and a very fascinating way of standing so tall. He said the roots spread sideways, and when they spread sideways, they get entangled with each other, and they create such a strong foundation for each other that they hold each other up. And this, to me, left a very, very deep impact, because I felt that that's what society is meant to be. We're supposed to hold each other up and not bring each other down. You guys have all chosen medicine as your line, and as doctors, I would love to see you all going tall and high and reaching great heights in your careers. But don't ever forget that your roots have to hold each other, and especially your patients and the less fortunate. So with that, thank you so much. I now ask my colleague
Special round of applause for Singh Ma'am, coming out of the North of Sun, and taking this initiative to benefit the society, human race, and such, because a lot of motivation, a lot of faith, a lot of will, because the stem cell donation is not happening in India, and people are not aware of it. Good job being done by the foundation. I'd like to invite Jasmin Bhattacharya to please tell us the process of stem cell donation. I request the speakers not to please limit your presentation not more than 10 minutes because we are running short of time. Just need your presentation and I request you to please finish it in 10 minutes. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'll be quick 10 minutes and we'll be done. That's urgent. As we already told you that this foundation runs in memory of Rajendra Singh, who himself wanted to be a part of it. Unfortunately, he's not among us, but we have this dream. We are living his dream, and we want you to be a part of this journey with us so that we can save more lives. Who would want to be available for others? Blood cancers, thalassemia, sickle cell anemia, hepatocellular, and all those secondary types of blood diseases are treatable, can be cured. The only thing we are lacking behind in India is awareness, and that we are a part of the family of this worldwide family of donors. Every 27 seconds, there is a patient diagnosed, and we can save them. That's two patients every minute almost. I won't take you through the facts, but I'll take you through the procedure in case of anesthesia and we can all go for lunch. Stem cells, everybody knows about stem cells. Please raise your hands. Yeah, a few hands. Brilliant, thank you. There are five types of stem cells in a body. we're speaking about hematopoietic stem cells who are responsible for making blood components, regeneration, maintenance, and generating them. Bone marrow is a very soft tissue, resides within your bones, basically in the backbone, and the hip bones, the large bones in your body, is responsible to make the blood components of your body. That's your red blood cells, white blood cells, platelets, and everything else. We're clear about stem cells being the mother cell, and it creates a tissue called bone marrow, and then bone marrow is responsible for making all the blood components. If the bone marrow is malfunctioning due to some DNA mutation, which may create some genetic problem, or some other problems which we don't know why it's malfunctioning, there could be underproduction of the blood components, overproduction, and it cannot produce all of the blood components. Depending on the malfunction of bone marrow, then the diseases are diagnosed and categorized. It could be leukemia, lymphomas, thalassemia, sickle cell, and all other types of blood disorders. Having said that, if batteries in our remotes at home die out, what we do is just put the new ones in. And that's exactly what we're doing. Like Dr. Mehra was talking about kidney transplantation. If the kidney is not working, we borrow it from someone else. Sorry, not borrow it, just take it from them as a recipient and they donate it to us. Similarly, if the marrow is not functioning correctly, we give the recipient, a patient, a matching donor's stem cells so that the body can graft itself and creates new marrow and it functions as we people more. But the problem comes here is it's not changing the batteries. The problem is that you're not finding these batteries, and the batteries are the matching stem cell donors. For that, in your own family, my brother, when I need stem cells tomorrow, my brother has only 25% chances that he would be my donor. But in case he doesn't become my donor, I would have to rely upon the worldwide donor database. Whether my HA having matches to another donor, which is 1 in a million chance anyway. So out of you, how many of people are A positive blood group? Please raise your hands. So many, thank you. So if I need blood tomorrow, I may request one of you, you'll be able to donate. Happy go lucky. But if I need stem cells, this is what you need to be matching. This is my HA typing. So you have to match HA A, B, C, D, R, B, 1, D, Q, B, 1 is a perfect 10 out of 10 match. Unfortunately, finding this is 1 in a million chance. So out of 200 of you today, I have almost about 10 donors for blood. But if I need stem cells tomorrow, there will be 1 out of 1 million, and we haven't tested that million yet. That's where the problem is. We need to get more donors on the database, more people to know what their HLA typing is. How will we do this? I'll take you through it. So if you want to become a donor first, all you have to do is make up your mind that you can donate to stem cells, and that will quickly go through. Anybody who's donated blood here, please use your hands. Brilliant. This is all medical fraternity. I'm sure you're pretty good at it. Platelet donation. Anybody for platelet donation? Okay, that's a bit difficult one because it takes a longer time and there are 2 meals involved instead of one. Stem cell donation is similar to platelet donation. That's what it looks like. 2 needles, 1 in your left arm, 1 in your right arm. The blood comes out of your left arm, spins in a machine. The process is called apheresis, just like platelet donation. We collect the stem cells out of that blood and give the rest of the blood back to your body. So the stem cells, what are extracted from you are, prior to this donation, you are given a G-CSF therapy. So you'll be given an injection for first 5 days prior to your donation date. Those injections, the G-CSF is going to increase, catalyze the multiplication of stem cells in your body. And on the 6th day, when you go to a hospital, a local facility, just like that, you'll sit on a couch, 2 meters being inserted, 1 in the left arm, 1 in the right arm, and the procedure will be done. And what we had extracted from you is what we had multiplied 5 days earlier. So your loss is literally, perhaps the research we know is only about 5% of your own stem cells, and that's about it. Does that sound easy? Please say yes or no. donation does not cause you any harm. In the history of past three decades of stem cell donation, there hasn't been no casualty so far. We haven't heard anybody dying of blood donation. Nobody with a common site of native donation. And yes, nobody with a common side effect of stem cell donation. All you need to do is, when you do become a donor, you have to be completely informed that you'll be filling up a form and promising to save a life in future, because you are not donating right now. All you're doing is committing that you will become a stem cell donor in future. You'll fill up a form. We'll give you a form. The registration tab is just outside the auditorium. We'll take a cheek swab. All of you would know what is a cheek swab. That will collect your DNA, and that is then sent to an international lab for HLA typing. Like Dr. Mehra has already mentioned it to you, the NGS testing is the latest one, and it's the best one right now. So all your tests will be done on NGS, and it's all the high resolution HLA typing. Similar to this would be your HLA typing. The combination of solutions will be different. Then this data gets coded. All your personal details will remain in our systems. We'll give you a code. That code will be stuck up on your sample and be sent to an international lab. When the report comes, that report with that code is then sent to the WMD, the World Rand Donors Association, where the whole world's database is available for research. So there are about 80 registries around the world. All of us maintain our database personally in our own servers and then share it with WMDA. So if somebody is looking for a match, we will run a search. Any of the 80 organizations around the world can run a search in that particular database. So all your information is completely safe with us, it's confidential, no loss of data at any point, and you can avail your HLA typing if you require. After the donation, we give you a complete health check to make sure everything is fine, and we do the DSA and all of the tests that patient shouldn't have any problem and you shouldn't have any problem. After the clearance, only this procedure takes place at an agreed center. So you wouldn't have to move from your place to somewhere else. We may be able to return some donation here. We'll see in case you do become a donor, we'll speak to the management and see if there is available. And then the cell product, the stem cell product, is then transmitted to the transplant center. If in India on the same day, if it's outside, there is a time gap of 48 hours that you must send the stem cells to the transplant center. The problem, again, AIIMS already mentioned it, I'll mention it, that 1.3 billion population and Indians now in every part of the world may need stem cell transplant. Like Mike is an individual, and I came in, and all your doctors would then tell you to go back to your ethnic origin from where you belong to go find a match there. Of course, we might match you a white American of very rare chances. We match an Indian person would be an easier of a chance. But in India, with 1.3 billion plus population, we only have less than 6 lakh donors at this very moment. So with medical fraternity here in the future of India, we request you to make sure you join the registries. And I note that I'm going 2 minutes. I request you to be a part of the registry, be a part of this future donor program, that whenever somebody needs a match, whenever somebody needs a stem cell transplant, we are available to save our own gene siblings. And we are, our tagline is be someone's DNA, and that came up from a very clear incident that you know that after the stem cell transplant, the body gives on double DNA. So you can donate your stem cells and we can then later on see that the person is living your life as well with them. Thank you. Does have a program that up to 365 days off a transplant, you will be meeting your own patient. So a live given by you will be right in front of your eyes, and you can meet your patient, and that is something which is very heartwarming,
and is not available anywhere else in the world. So I request you guys, please become donors and be a part of the registry. Thank you so much. If you have any questions, we are right outside. Please ask us. Thank you.
We can applause on behalf of the members of the donation. I'm sorry we are running short of time, so we had to send that person to you. But yes, we might have this session once again, in which you can explain us in detail what is it all about. Now, moving ahead, the last, but not the least, I would request again, Professor Dr. N.K. Manager to please tell us the national guidelines of stem cell research and therapy. A big round of applause for Professor Dr. N.K. Mehra, sir.
I'm so glad to meet these two very big women here. I knew of one Dr. Shobhat Pune. So you know her. She used to talk to me in the 80s. Her daughter was in the DPS. And she was talking from Palestinian. And you know, they told you that thalassemia, the family size is very small. There's only one child, there are only two. Yet we do find a lot of them in HLA-negative specific cluster. You know that thalassemia is a problem with India. Thalassemia is a problem of Mediterranean religion and the same. I'm born and brought up in Amritsar. In language is you. And I used to be very fond of going to Lahore because, you know, during my childhood in the 50s, people were all the time talking about Lahore. And I used to get a lot of phone calls when I was in AIIMS from patients from Karachi, same village. I used to be very high. And I did go to Lahore in 1999. I had an invitation from Imran Khan at that time because he had opened a cancer hospital there in the name of his mother. And I met families there of thalassemia, where there was not one child, not with three children with thalassemia. And we used to call them all the way from Delhi. And we used to do it here, I think, for them to find out the donor, but how can we do? They may have only one having. So the lack of awareness is also there, but madam, you have devoted part of your life the donor selection and the donor recruitment. Shobha has also done that, Shobha Julian, he is now the brain behind everything there. And we every year have parent children or a meet where we call him. And I have given the lectures over there many times. Organ transplant is something that I told you about, but our major problem is hematopoietic stem cell transplantation. Finding a donor for patient, please over there, who may not have an HLA-negative sibling, unlike organ transplant, the mother, father, or liver, if seeking, now we no longer call it as bone marrow transplantation. We call it hematopoietic stem cell transplantation before. Now the source of stem cells is not only does the marrow, but it could be a hepatic blood, it could be heart blood, it could be other sources there. And there are all kinds of research company also take samples from the human condition. The problem here is that we need an HLA-negative sibling. And as I showed you a slide, creatinine is only 25% chance that we will have an HLA-negative sibling here. And we have not seen, that the brother, sister with whom you find a lot maybe HLA-negative. In our practice in AIIMS, we used to see 30% of the patients that came to us of any of the diseases over there had an HLA-negative sibling. So they were transplanted. And the success rate in India is not as good as anywhere in the world. students of today have to really learn a lot about hematopoietic stem cell transplantation. Because this is going to grow even more. And we have been trying to work with the Department of India to these are the options for somebody who has undergone disease, where do we get a donor? Say, that's a possibility, a sibling, or a match with the related donor from the religious people. By the way, you are all really good donors, you know? Yeah. And we normally ask, I created an institute at AIIMS in 1994, Asian Indian Donor Memorial Registry, AMR. We had no money, So what we were doing, patients who came to us for either a kidney transplant or bone marrow transplant, and somebody else is sibling in the family would say, we want to recruit you as a donor in our Asian Indian Donor Memorial Registry. But not only fighting, we want to create IMBR, the Indian Marrow Donor Registry. There are some couple of private donor registries over there. But the main members in this house, all of you, please register as a donor. Women are also good, but we normally don't encourage them because you know, they make children and therefore there are antibody issues and all that. But a young man, of 18, 20s, and early 30s of age, would be a very good donor for us, because you could be a donor up to 60, 70 years of age. We don't know whether any time in your life you could be called upon. Because you need to find somebody who is a well match for you. You saw that in kidney transplant, we need to have a very large recipient pool. Recipient pool is very large, somebody dying, a road traffic accident, the donor is only one. In the HSCT is the other way around. We need a very large donor pool. And that's what we call in terms of unrelated donor registries over there, where you are contributing a lot. I would like to take your phone numbers, and I would say, actually, you are trying to make me as a detective. I have told them I will not leave this earth unless an Indian marrow donor registry is made. No, we need an Indian marrow donor registry. We need a registry of at least a million donors whose HIV typing is done. HIV typing done with the NGS data. Next generation. We have been also trying to improve on the technology that the NGS based typing can be done with about 30 dollars. You know, as cheap as we can. So these are the donors that we have. This was the document. So we can be talking about the stem cells. I have also brought the stem cell paradigms with the other stem cell research, the mesenchymal stem cell research. And I wrote the stem cell guidelines for the international guidelines. So what I told you about, even what came my side, and these are the ways that we try to find a donor. We have been doing this since the 80s, 1980s in AIIMS. Of course, the country is very large. And the message doesn't go around. But I'm really happy to say that I'm sure many people at the Donor Transplant Center, or what we call it, this is our limit here is we want a 20% age. There's only 1 in 4,000 in the family, unfortunately. And it's a lot of people. But the other problem that we have in here is, why is it difficult to find an independent unrelated donor? And extensive diversity of aging is something that is true. So what is more important to me is over there. No age or disease. She was lucky to find a donor from the WMBA, which is in the US, for her son. So a lot of us have what we call normal means. Not only work, I have over 100 members in here. If we found out that the Indian population and they are not counting that we are yet to the pool. Hence, this is what we try to convince about. They need to you have an Indian melanoma history, I want to just give you one example. I know we are late, but if this is an important example. For example, this is a HLA-8, very common. If I do the HLA test, the whole hall over here, at least 40% of you will be HLA-8. But now with the NGS, we can define many more facts. Because if the population in the West are yellow part, and the black is yellow, and then this is the Japanese, it is but the heavy yellow part. What would you expect in India? In India, you would expect a kidney. This is about of the HLA-2. Our yellow part has gone down.
We have all the needs that this line and this line have. And then this red part.
The red part is open them, this is not clean in the operation. There is not the HLA-2 possibly for that. This one. And you're not going to find this on the government of the EFO. Because the company of Indian religion has this. And you know, the other population that we found which has this unique or non-subtype postal level are the gypsies. We had by chance done a study of the Hungarian gypsies. And even your grandmas have been telling you that gypsies anywhere in the world have actually gone from India. This is rather true. 10% of the Hungarian population. We were trying to have a collaboration with the Hungarian registry. Because 10% of the population are Hungarian, are the gypsies. They look like us. They were saying that the gypsies anywhere in the world are wrong in there. This practice that we face, I really don't want to go into the details of it. I talked about the Indian Network of the Registry, which we are trying to make, and hopefully it should see the light. Don't want to go further details. I know we are running short of time, but I want to end here to tell you that besides the addiction, there is more challenge for finding a donor for those who require sex. Thank you very much. It was very nice to meet the young people. Other part that I missed is I made a book over here. We wrote a central line. We wanted a lot of doctors who want to try central as a threat mode or as a research mode, try and make cure a lot of the diseases. We need a kind of sensors on the ground sensors. Thank you very much.
Now I'd like to invite our director of Pankaj Singh sir and our Vice-Chancellor sir to please give the participate the best of today. Our director sir and Vice-Chancellor. Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. It's an honor, a privilege to have you amongst us. Thanks for taking our time and delivering the speech, the lecture. Okay. Thank you. Thanks a lot, sir. Thank you. I'd like to.
National guidelines for central research. This is going to be the kind of
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. So kind of you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, dignitaries. And now I would like to invite the principal and controller of NIMS University College, Dr. Meenaxi Saxena, to please deliver the board of NIMS. Closing remarks.